When you look back on this last legislative session, what were the biggest successes?
I think getting a G bill passed was a success, because when we first came into session, I didn't think we were going to be able to do that. That was probably the biggest. The housing, workforce housing, that's big. It's a lot of money. It's an obvious need. I know there's still a fight over where that money's going to go. But I think the legislature sent a pretty clear message of where they want to see it go.
Say more about that. Why didn't you think it would get done?
I didn't think we were going to get it done just because of the lack of communication between the administration and then both houses. Seemed like the communication wasn't there. And it wasn't towards about the very last week, when they started involving everybody, that we came up with a plan to go forward and get this, get the G-bill accomplished, get some of those one-time spenders accomplished. You know, this legislative session is, South Dakota has never had access to resources like we've had, and largely in part due to, you know, the federal money that has come in from the Biden administration. So, you know, those are all worthy programs that we were putting money towards. We know they're going to provide jobs. They're going to provide housing and infrastructure for people across South Dakota. So, you know, I'm excited to see where they go. It was just, there was a lot of argument as to how that money should be spent.
Mm-hmm. What were some of the pieces that had to be left behind when it comes to the budget specifically?
You know, I think we left out a few things that were specific bills that geared money towards specific projects. But a lot of those will be rolled over into, you know, one of these other programs. So, you know, we'll see if, for instance, the water pipeline going out west, you know, we'll see what kind of support that gets throughout that process. Though we killed that specific bill, they said it would be folded into what DENR is able to do. So, some things like that, you know, the Office of Missing and Murdered Indigenous People. You know, we should have funded that last year when we passed it, but we didn't. And it didn't look like it was going to get funded. And then we were able to negotiate and get that as a permanent program, you know, in a permanent budget. So. And there was a specific bill for it. We just didn't need it at the end because we made the case to have that in the budget.
And that's separate from the Native Hope donation and then?
So, you know, Native Hope came in, which was a great thing because we weren't sure we were going to get it funded. And, you know, the donation that they made, they stepped up and they saw that, you know, this is a community of need. Obviously, with the students and the families that they represent, they said, we're going to do something. And I think that did help spur, you know, the momentum to get that permanently in the budget. And I'm sure, you know, between the Office of the Attorney General, they're going to find uses for that money because, you know, it's still a major issue in South Dakota.
You and I have talked before about Native education. This year, Senate Bill 139 at its end in the House committee. What are you hearing in those arguments?
You know, I was disappointed. A lot of the people who voted against it will stand up and use this very same argument for passage of something that they support. So I just didn't understand their apprehension. I was really disappointed. There was a representative that voted against it because we used the word equity. And you know, I just don't understand how you could be, you know, in South Dakota and not realize that there is some inequity, especially as it comes to education for Native kids. And just by using the word equity was a trigger. And so that caused that representative to vote against it. That didn't make any sense to me. You know, I'm sure I'm sure another version or something like this will come along. I think we've really raised the issue, and we have a lot of support. I think we have a lot of support statewide. We just have to figure out and, you know, get the willpower to do it.
Do you think once some lawmakers see a working example of a school like this, that it'll help shift their perspective? Or is that not the critical issue?
You know, I don't know. I think it's just right now in the current political climate, it seems like we're running away from what would help Native kids be successful. And that's, you know, being able to teach with relevance and identity. And at the same time, educating, you know, non-Native students as to, you know, why this place is important. You know, what is our connection to this land? And what is our connection to, you know, this space? You know, so great learning opportunities are thwarted because of politics.
We talked a bit with Senator Kamak about the different vision between House Republicans and Senate Republicans and how the supermajority leaves more room for those differences. How has that impacted how South Dakota Democrats approached things this session?
Well, we know that, you know, we have to gain support from the other side of the aisle or we're not going to get anything accomplished. And a lot of that is creating relationships and explaining the issues. You know, many of most of the Democrats in South Dakota or in the legislature, at least, you know, come from reservation communities. So, you know, explaining some of those issues and working with the majority party because they're not connected to it. You know, they don't live by one. They don't, you know, do their business in a reservation community. So we have to do a good job of explaining that. Or the downtown urban Sioux Falls, you know, District 15, which has some unique issues compared to, you know, other places in the state. I think the issue has been the last few years as Democratic numbers decline. I think so has the level of cooperation and understanding. It wasn't until they brought Democratic leadership in on the G-Bill that we really started to see some movement. And it takes another set of eyes. You know, it takes another perspective to get things accomplished. And, you know, I think that's what we bring. We try to do it, you know, in a respectful manner. Obviously, there's things that we wish we could stop. We just don't have the numbers to stop it. And there's things we wish we could pass, and we just don't have the numbers to get it passed. But for the most part, if we had more balance, I think we'd get a better product.
How have you seen the influence of the Democratic Party in the State House shift in your time as a legislator?
You know, when I came in, we had some real heavyweights. Jim Peterson, Bernie Hunhoff, Julie Bartling, just real, outstanding legislators with a long history, with, you know, the institutional knowledge. So it was really neat to see that. And then that's when you saw the start of Jason Ferrix and Billy Sutton and kind of that era. And then the ones who have come, you know, after me. I think the hardest part right now is, though our numbers are small, we do stick together. You know, we were able to do that the last couple years on the 3% for teachers and community support providers and state employees. We stuck to our guns, and they weren't going to be able to pass it without, you know, those votes in the House. And we stuck to our guns, and we got that through. This year with the G-Bill, it was going to be the same thing. You know, we might not have been able to stop it in the Senate, but those House Dems could have tanked the whole thing, and they knew it. And so once we all got on the same plan and as leadership and started going forward, that's when we saw some cooperation and some conversation that I think made the legislature a little stronger.
Do you have any, predictions maybe isn't the best word, but for how the redistricting process will kind of influence things moving forward?
You know, I was on the redistricting commission, and I will never do that again. that was painful. I think we came out with some districts that are going to be beneficial to us. So I'm hoping that candidates get their petitions turned in and, you know, get out and meet people and work to get be a representative of their district. But South Dakota really needs to look at how we redistrict. You know, in 10 years, we might have hardly anybody representing the center of the state, and everything's going to be concentrated to the east and to the west. And I worry about that, and that's in our constitution. So I'm hoping that future legislatures take a look at this issue. Obviously we're going to have to send that to the voters for them to approve. But as our districts start to stretch out, you lose that local representation. I already represent six districts, and next year we have portions of two other counties coming into this district. So they're just going to keep getting bigger, and pretty soon you're not even going to know who represents you, and that person may not be familiar with the community that you're from.
And I think that's an interesting point for these very large districts. How have you managed that during your time?
It's been kind of interesting. So I have extreme right and extreme left in my district. So somebody's mad at me all the time. And I think I've just made it so, or tried to get so if everybody's mad at me equally, then I've done a good job. Because you surely can't please everybody. You just have to really focus on, what were you sent there to do, and what does that mean for your district? And be a legislator, not somebody who's working for the administration or, some other entity. You're supposed to represent your district, and that's what I tried to do.
What were some of the toughest losses or the hardest compromises from this session?
The hardest loss for me was obviously the Ocheti Shakoi community-based school. I really thought we had a good product. We had some momentum coming out of the Senate. I thought we had made our case in the House. Who knew that critical race theory and those kind of buzzwords were going to overtake a bill that had a chance to transform education for Native youth in South Dakota. So that was probably the biggest disappointment for me personally. The transgender sports bill, that it's just such a non-issue in South Dakota. And we just saw a lot of that. We saw a lot of this, national kind of rhetoric that was brought forth in all kinds of bills, and not a lot of them being brought by the legislature, but, coming from the administration. And, that isn't what we were sent there to do.
Thinking back over your time in the State House, what inspired you to public service for this community?
I've just always had a sense that if you're not at the table, then you're on the menu. And the people that I represent, the people from my community down here on Rosebud, and the people in Lower Brule and Crow Creek, and then all across our district, they deserve somebody who can stand up and speak for them and try to bring issues to light. Far too often we are forgotten or ignored. And so when I got there, I was gonna make sure they weren't gonna ignore me. They might not have agreed with me, but they weren't gonna ignore me.
You talked a bit about your relationship with Senator Kamak. Can you say a bit more about that? Working kind of across the aisle?
Gary is a good man. He really is a good man. I always appreciated our friendship. We came in at the same time together. So, from two completely different areas, but a lot of similar backgrounds, ranching, farming communities, a small town, everybody kind of knows everybody. And we, once we started visiting, you know, we realized we had a lot of common friends. You know, we had just never crossed paths. I always found him to be fair. I can't imagine the pressure that he was under. You know, it's in some ways, being the minority leader is a lot easier. One is you don't have as many people to manage, and you don't really have to try to guide the whole ship all the time. I can't imagine the pressure he was under, not only from his own caucus, but also dealing with the administration and their wishes. So, you know, he did a good job. He was always fair to me, and I will always appreciate that.
What are you most proud of?
You know, I've been thinking of that, and there's so many. There's a lot of bills that I got passed that never really got any press, which is fine. That wasn't what I was doing it for. But, you know, I passed a bill that banned forced catheterization of minors. That was a practice that was going on. And when I heard about it, I mean, that was just wrong. We shouldn't do that. Being part of the Blue Ribbon Task Force and, you know, changing how we pay teachers in this state, you know, that's going to have a lasting effect. The Opportunity Scholarship, that has potential to change lives for kids for generations. So being part of those things, you know, I'm very proud that I was there and was able to stand up and support those kind of efforts.
There was a time when people were wondering, is he going to run for governor? I know you've come out publicly and said that that's not the case, but would you tell us a bit more about that decision?
You know, we had been going back and forth, whether I was going to or not. Obviously, I was interested. I thought I could do a good job for South Dakota. I thought I had developed quite a few relationships across the state. Had lots of encouragement from all different walks of life, all different parties. They just wanted somebody that would be in South Dakota. And it was in November. I didn't want to do anything during redistricting because I didn't want to taint that process. That was hard enough. And if I was running for governor, somebody had said, well, he's trying to, you know, put more people here, you know, to win this district. And I didn't want to do that. This redistricting was far too important. And it was right after redistricting, I was approached by the Intertribal Buffalo Council and encouraged to apply for their executive director position. And it's a group that I had worked with before. So I truly believe in their vision and their mission. It was just a great fit. So I accepted that position, and I knew if I would have accepted that position and ran for governor, I wouldn't have done either of them worth a darn. So just made a choice to try something else for a while and see where that takes me, and it's been really busy so far.
Could you tell us a bit more about your new role?
Sure. ITBC has 76 member tribes clear across the nation. We've got tribes in 20 states, over 55 herds, over 20,000 buffalo collectively. You know, and our goal is to restore buffalo back to Indian lands. It involves a lot of policy work, at the federal level. So, we visit with senators and congressmen. We also have to work with states, you know, obviously on import requirements. We run a big surplus program, so we work with national parks and other reserves, federal reserves, to get buffalo out of and relocate them to tribal lands. So it's really exciting, and I have a great board. They represent all areas of the nation, and it's nice to hear what they're trying to do, with their buffalo for their people, and seeing and then relating that back to, you know, South Dakota and the people that, I used to represent or still do for a little while anyway, but knowing the tribes, that, you know, all nine tribes of South Dakota are members of ITBC, So I'm very familiar with the tribes, and now getting to know, you know, their buffalo herd managers as well. So,
mm-hmm. Is there anything else that you can think to add that you want to say that I didn't ask about?
I think, you know, serving in the legislature is extremely important. And sometimes I think maybe as a legislator, you get a little full of yourself. And I don't know about anywhere else, but, you know, down here it can humble you pretty quick. But it is extremely important. And I hope that future legislatures, I always just kind of wonder, will they ever sit there and say, I wonder what Heinert would say? And I hope I've made a big enough impact and created enough relationships that you know, those thoughts will still permeate through my colleagues. And, you know, I'm not dying, I'm not done forever, but, you know, I worked very hard at it, and I tried very hard, and I think we've done some good things for people in South Dakota. I'm excited to see what the next generation can do, and, you know, it's important.